Hello, Cloud Gurus, and welcome to 2020. I'm Nigel Poulton, and this is Kubernetes This Month. Now, even though it's a new year, we're sticking with our usual format. So we'll start off with a rundown of the latest news in the Kubernetes world. Then we'll pick a couple of those and dive a bit deeper. Then we'll wrap things up with a Guru of the Month question. So make yourself comfortable and get ready to enjoy. Now then, a lot of the world has been in holiday mode, yeah? So not the busiest of months on the development front, but don't worry, there has still been some interesting stuff, of which front and center was the release of Kubernetes 1.17, the fourth and final release of 2019. Now, this is becoming customary now, but there was so much stuff going GA. In fact, I think the press release on the Kubernetes website listed 22 enhancements, 14 of which were features going into GA. Now, a couple of interesting features that aren't quite GA, but got significant beta releases, were volume snapshots and CSI migrations. And we'll take a closer look at these in the deeper dive section in just a second. Moving away from upstream Kubernetes though, and onto the managed Kubernetes space, GKE, the Google Kubernetes Engine, announced general availability of maintenance windows and maintenance exclusions, and more on these in a second as well. Sticking for a minute though with managed Kubernetes, Azure Kubernetes Service announced a public beta of private AKS clusters. This is where your managed Kubernetes control plane gets a private IP address and can be accessed by remote nodes via an Azure private link service. Basically, no public networks involved. EKS, Amazon's managed Kubernetes service, announced GA of EKS on Fargate and EKS managed node groups. Now, both of these features extend the capabilities of EKS from simply a managed control plane into the world of nodes or the underlying infrastructure of running your application pods as well. So in the case of managed node groups, you can manage your Kubernetes worker nodes in a more integrated way. So operations like adding and removing nodes and upgrading them is way more integrated. And on the EKS and Fargate front, you don't even need nodes for your pods. They just run on Fargate, which is effectively an infinite pool to run your pods. So good stuff there. Now, away from managed Kubernetes and onto Envoy. Last month, we mentioned that Envoy 1.12 was released. Well, this month, 1.12.2 is a really important security-related update. Basically, if you're running Envoy and your version is older or lower than 1.12.1, you should definitely update to 1.12.2. Now, likewise, as Envoy is heavily used by other platforms, you should also check those platforms for updates as well. For example, Istio uses Envoy, and Istio has released its own updates with the same security fixes. And last but not least this month, also relating to Envoy, Solo has announced the WebAssembly Hub. So the idea here is based on the fact that the best way to extend Envoy is using WebAssembly. Therefore, WebAssembly Hub is a place to share and discover extensions to Envoy. But you know what, as well as that, it allows you to build and deploy. So building means that it can take your code and build it into a WebAssembly extension for Envoy. And as you might guess, the deploy part lets you add that extension to Envoy, or even, you know what, you can add it to Istio or Glue or any other Envoy-based products that support WebAssembly. And that about wraps up the major news for the month. Okay, in this month's deeper dive section, we'll look a bit closer at volume snapshots and CSI migration and maintenance windows for GKE clusters. So, first up is a couple of things moving into beta in Kubernetes 1.17. Now, for quite a while, the CSI or the container storage interface has been the preferred way to write and deploy storage drivers for Kubernetes. So, like connecting your cloud's native storage service or your on-premises storage resources into your Kubernetes cluster. And it's all good and all, right? The CSI is great, but there is a debt of legacy in-tree drivers already out there. And migrating those old in-tree drivers to the newest CSI drivers, well, it just hasn't been easy, and the community knew that. this is where the CSI migration comes in. So CSI migration went beta in Kubernetes 1.17, and the premise is to provide a simple way to migrate from the old in-tree drivers over to CSI, with Kubernetes doing the hard work for you behind the scenes. Now, it's not GA yet, but it is a significant step towards getting us all on the CSI, and I'm happy that this is getting closer. Sticking with the topic of storage, volume snapshots also move to beta. The idea of a snapshot, right, being you take a point in time copy of a volume and its associated data. And then that point in time copy is useful for loads of things, like recovering lost data, or even recovering an entire broken system to a particular point in time. Like, I don't know, if you take a snapshot every hour, you can recover your data or your system to any of those hourly snapshots. Anyway, look, in the past, you always had to talk directly to your storage system to do stuff like this. And as you'd imagine, every storage system, of course, has its own peculiar commands for doing this, which is a royal pain and not good for portability. Well, snapshots in Kubernetes follows the Kubernetes pattern of abstracting that underlying infrastructure so that Kubernetes is the common denominator, meaning it doesn't matter if your storage behind the scenes is like a cloud storage system or an on-premises NetApp or EMC or something. None of that matters anymore. We just talk to the Kubernetes API. Now, this is currently in beta, and right now, not every CSI driver supports snapshots. I think at the time we're recording this, it's just the GCE persistent disk driver, Portworx, and NetApp. But we're headed in the right direction. Right, GKE maintenance windows and exclusions. I really like this, and for a couple of reasons, right? First up, I'm a fan of hosted Kubernetes, but also stuff like this, it just makes things a lot more production grade. Anyway, GKE, Google's hosted Kubernetes engine, now lets you specify windows during which GKE is allowed to carry out maintenance on your cluster, things like upgrading the control plane. And this is important, of course, because during certain maintenance tasks, your cluster is effectively read-only, meaning you can't update your configs or scale your applications. Yeah, I mean, your apps still work as normal, but you can't scale them or fix them or anything. So the ability to say to GKE, these are my quiet times and these are my business critical times, and have it schedule maintenance accordingly, it's just a step forward in maturity. Now, the principle of know thy infrastructure still applies. And in this case, you should read the small print, because there may be times when GKE overrides your windows for critical updates and the likes. But these are a couple of great new features. And that wraps up our deeper dive section. Okay, guru of the month, and I've been looking forward to this because last month's question generated a ton of interest, including, and I think for the first time, some incorrect answers. Now, that's totally fine, right? We want to make this fun, and wrong answers are absolutely allowed. Anyway, last month's question was about how the Kubernetes pod network is generally implemented, and the correct answer was C, as a VXLAN overlay. So no, not as a layer 2 VLAN, as some people answered, and certainly not as a NetBUI network, which thankfully nobody guessed. Either way, this month's winner is Stanislav Yanali Emiliev, or StazDX on the forum. Staz is a senior DevOps dude, and he is from Peru. So Staz, great answer, we're shipping you a goodie bag. And thanks everyone else for getting involved, it's good fun. This month's question is in the forum link below, go check it out, and as always, I'll see you again next month. Same cube time, same cube place.